Welcome to the third Geopolymer Camp. In 2009, Professor Friven from the University of Illinois and myself decided to organize each year two conferences on Geopolymer. The first one in Florida, in Daytona Beach, within the frame of the American Ceramic Society meeting on advanced ceramic. And the second one, the Geopolymer Camp in July in Saint-Quentin. So this is the third of an issue which I hope will continue as long as I can. This is the state of the Geopolymer Research and Development 2011. The previous state of the keynotes have been recorded on video. The first one in 2009 had the general theme mass-produced geopolymer cement. And last year I started the state of the geopolymer R&D. This is what I will do each year. For 2011, it comprises four parts: geopolymer science, geopolymer technologies, geopolymer cement and concrete, and geopolymer and archaeology. Archaeology is always part of my geopolymer research, and it deserves to be presented. Let us start with geopolymer science. It is interesting to follow how long it took to emerge from a confidential research project into worldwide science and technology. We start at our first geopolymer conference is on the numbers of laboratories that were involved, and then it increased and increased and increased. These are the numbers of laboratories working in the world on geopolymer science. And it is obvious that the number of laboratories has an input on the numbers of scientific publications that are published each year. At the beginning, we had a few every year, and starting in 1997, through the input of the colleagues at University of Melbourne in Australia, we got a small burst, and then it increases exponentially. It is only in 2007 that I felt ready to write the book on geopolymer chemistry and application. Since 2008, we saw seven exemplars, and we have a translation in Chinese that is now ready and will be published very soon. And I'm presenting this year today the third edition that is now available. I put in my book at the end of each chapter some research topic that deserves to be made and by the different laboratories. And at the beginning I had 14, now we have 15. The first one is on the polymeric character of geopolymers and deal with the geopolymer micelles or nanoparticulates, and now we have the sodium processing. The second is on the polysiliconate on the water glass, the soluble silicate, and in fact it's now based on microsilicate, silica fume, and rice salts in order to make the water glasses. The third is what can be done on metakaolin. So we have new raw material, lithium arch, and synthetic metakaolin. Calcium-based geopolymer, there is no improvement since 2008. Rock-based geopolymer cement, no improvement. Silica-based geopolymer, no improvement. Fly ash-based geopolymer, no improvement. Major improvement are on phosphate-based geopolymer with introduction of the aluminum phosphate isomorphs. Organic mineralogical polymers are very important. We have a lot of labs working with the introduction of organic species within the structure, phenolic, water-based latex, etchinester silicates, and so forth. Long-term durability, no major improvement. Geopolymer fiber composite, we have improvements in terms of high temperature, and there will be a paper on that this afternoon. Geopolymer and ceramic processing, we have improvement by exotic ceramics, including cesium, lithium, gallium, and germanium ingredients. Number 13, manufacture of geopolymer material. We have a lot of new materials. Geopolymer concrete has large, no improvement. And we added 15 more materials for medicinal applications. One of the major breakthroughs that I consider is the paper by a Chinese team Xiuming Cui at Zhangxi University. Characterization of Shimu synthetic L2O3 to SiO2 geopolymers. It is in fact the manufacture, the production of synthetic metalloy. We're no longer dealing with the natural one, but we are manufacturing it. And this is just an excerpt of the abstract. Pure chemosynthetic L2O3 to SiO2 geopolymer precursor were effectively fabricated using a sol-gel method. And the sol-gel method involved tetraethylene ortosilicate for the silico part and aluminum nitrate for the aluminum part. The molecular structure of the geopolymer precursor powder was investigated by NMR. And the NMR data revealed that after calcination at 300-800°C, the chemosynthetic powders contain L5 species, just like metachlorine MK750. And if we follow the evolution of the NMR for 27L aluminum with the temperature, we start at 20°C with the AL6 and 600 and 800 were the production of the very reactive A4 and A5. On the right, we have the synthetic metakaolin, so produced with A4 and A5, and the resulting geopolymer. It is obvious that this type of production of synthetic metakaolin is not dedicated for applications in cement for more high cost and high value that we'll be discussing later. At the same time, this is strange, another Chinese team, those from Taiwan, also published a paper on solid state polymer study of geopolymer prepared by solid gel chemistry. This is a team from Taiwan at the National Taiwan University, associated with the University of Warwick in United Kingdom. But instead of aluminum nitrate, they used another aluminum species, aluminum isopropoxide. And for what purpose? This is a synthetic approach can offer a good opportunity for the medical applications of geopolymer. So there are several. Let us now look at new improvements in the so-called geopolymer technologies at large. I put this news on our website because I found it very interesting. World chemical company BASF launches a geopolymer product. The German chemical company PCI, Augsburg GmbH, a subsidiary of the world chemical company BASF, has launched a geopolymer joint product for the general public. It is the first geopolymer product indicated for the general public at large. When you go on their website, you see they describe what is the grout, and it is based on geopolymer technology. and down there, what are geopolymers we have. For example, it was possible to develop the junk rock during the hygienic surface that virtually cleans itself on the basis of geopolymers. Thanks to ideally adapted utilization properties, geopolymer technology makes it possible to create functional surface offering real additional benefits to the users. These are chemists, they understand the chemistry and they are adding a lot of ingredients in it. What is interesting is that this is the English pages, and the German pages are more interesting because they contain more information. For example, this one of German, Porsche und Entwickler der BASF, der führenden Chemieunternehmen der Welt, arbeiten gemeinsam daran, den Schatz der Geopolymer-Technologie für die Kunden der PCI nutzbar zu machen. Auf Englisch, scientists at BASF, the world-leading chemical company, are working to make available the treasure of geopolymer technology to the clients of PCI. The treasure of geopolymer technology. This is where we are. Wow! Okay, another interesting work on geopolymers is was published by a group, a Czech group of scientists, geopolymer-based catalytic new group of catalytic materials. When I started 30 years ago the research on what we call the geopolymer, I always stated the connection between geopolymers and zeolites. Geopolymers and molecular sieves that are heavily used in the catalytic, as catalysts in the catalytic industry. And here, this group is trying to make the system workable as a real catalyst. For that, they start with metacolin-based geopolymer and let them exchange with various cations. And what they claim that this is the method in order to provide catalytic oxidation of VOC, these are for volatile organic compounds, and through the oxidation, these volatile organic compounds are transformed into water and CO2, and this is what is happening in the catalysators and the automobiles. So they achieve high conversion with the decan. Decan is part of gasoline. And they claim that because of the high stability, thermal stability of the geopolymer, this is the ideal material to be used as a catalyst for automobile. This is a good link to the applications for automobile, for what we have been involved in on racing cars in 1997. This is a strange news that was issued in last year on racing cars. Mercedes takes backward step with blown diffuser. In fact, seven times world champion Michael Schumacher was complaining. He got the hot exhaust gases were melting the car. In fact, Mercedes was waiting on an order of incombustible spacecraft material made exclusively in France, but there were problems with delivery, says Ross Brown. It shows that high temperature structural composite are strongly in demand, and this is shown by the result presented by another Chinese team, the Professor De Shang Jia. Effects of high temperature heat treatment on the mechanical properties of unidirectional carbon fiber reinforced geopolymer composite. Professor Jia will have a keynote this afternoon on this subject. What we have here, we have the matrix geopolymer that has a flexural strength of 12.3, and when heated at 11 degrees C, it reaches 70 degrees C and is transformed into leucite. This is a potassium aluminum silicate, and applied to the composite, we get at 1,134 MPa, but this technique has a drawback. The matrix has cracks and a lot of porosity, and they found a solution with another system, improvement of high temperature mechanical properties of heat treated geopolymer composite by solid SiO2 impregnations, and they could achieve mechanical strength higher than 425 MPa, which is impressive. So they improved the system from 200 to 425 MPa. There are other commercial applications that we find on the internet. This one on aluminum composite panels. Jingshan Science and Technology Development is a Sino-Russian high-tech joint venture corporation, which is also an integration of science, technology and trade. The fireproof aluminum composite panels are made of two 0.5 millimeter thick aluminum sheets and fire-resistant geopolymer core. And these aluminum panels are suitable for buildings and decoration where good fire retardancy is required. Let us look at some patents. There are a lot of patents on geopolymer. This one is from a German company, published in 2011. The title, Geopolymeric Material, but in fact, more precisely, geopolymer coating, which due to the organic cross-linking, has very good adhesion and strength, essentially on metal, and the geopolymer results from solid gel preparation plus organic cross-links stable up to 950 degrees C. Another patent from Dow Chemical, the American company, is also titled Modified Geopolymer Composition, Processes and Use, and it is also an incorporation of organic sodium metacarnine 750-based geopolymer with slurry, plus 5 to 10% waterborne polystyrene butadiene latex. Latex is a waterborne system supplied by the Dow Chemical Company. The latex modified geopolymer was tested on a polystyrene foam substrate. This is in order to make a system that adhere on organic as a good glue. The system they are introducing this latex. This one is very interesting. Published in 2009 by a man Enquist from Sweden. It is very interesting. It is a composition for sustained drug delivery comprising geopolymer binder, and the abstract reads, the present invention relates to a sustained release medical composition comprising an active pharmaceutical ingredient and a geopolymeric binder. Preferably, the active pharmaceutical ingredient is combined with the geopolymeric binder during the formation of that binder. So this is the patent that was published in 2009. And then we get the scientific papers. And scientific papers, we discover that the inventor is Alan Anquist. This is the head of one department at Uppsala University in Sweden. Mechanically strong geopolymers offers new possibilities in treatment of chronic pain. And the abstract, geopolymers may solve the problem of finding materials for controlled release of high potent opioids, morphine, and so forth. The opioids can be embedded in metacarnine-based geopolymer pellets to provide prolonged release dosage forms with mechanical strength of the same order of magnitude as that of human teeth, which provide pills that are resistant, that cannot be destroyed by elderly people. This opens up new opportunities for future development of drug delivery for high potency drugs. 1 year later, they had a new paper. But this time, the shift from beta-carotene to sol-gel. They want more pure material, and they adapted the sol-gel methods developed by the Chinese team, Professor Kui. I invited Professor Enquist to come, and he could not. At the last minute, he had to decline. Otherwise, he would have presented his results as a keynote. So, this has been a brief survey of what is outside of geopolymer cement. And this is where, in fact, the driving force in chemistry is really working. On geopolymer cement and concrete, we have some problems. Terminology, infringement, and legal points. And I tell you what we get. When you go on the website, on the web, you find strange things. For example, website called geopolymer-polymer.com. Well, we had listed the name geopolymer.com in order to prevent that other people use it for wrong use. But in fact, nobody, this is the rule by internet, can prevent that one use geo-polymer, or geopolymer-mer, or geopolymer, or geopolymer.com. Okay. So we went to the site, and there was no physical address at all. So you see, you can, this is the geopolymer site. No physical address. So when we read carefully what was in the site, we discovered that in fact it was connected to a company called Hydrogen Materials in Florida. And then we learned more about this. We learned that they had a 1 year research contract and they paid $550,000 USD to the Catholic University of America in Washington, D.C. that they work for them. Never heard of them. They are working on geopolymer, but we never meet them. And in fact, Ivorum, the company, had its own website, and they call it GeoCement. So we have here everything. So we started to communicate with these people, because we have, in this site, examples of what we call infringement and legal points. They have pages that is called geopolymer process licensing. And in this, in April 2011, we read plant modifications for the licensing support as a licensor of geopolymers, as a licensor of geopolymers, the company Brown will provide. Or for new operation, as a licensor, new manufacturer of geopolymers, and so forth. So we contacted these people and said, look, geopolymer is a scientific general term, cannot be used as marketable material. You may not, cannot license it. And in June, they changed their web writings. And it says, plant modification, Ivorum will provide the following, period. The operation and Ivorum will provide the following. So we thought that the issue was solved, but it was not. Because on the other pages, they have definitions of what are green polymers, what are green geopolymers, inorganic polymers, and so forth. And it is a copy of our website, without any link, without any credits, without nothing. And when you look at geopolymer sketches, so you see the chemistry, that is the chemistry that I put 20 years ago. This is their chemistry with no link, with nothing. And for what? To promote a simple fly ash based cement. So this is the situation that we have on the web, and essentially in the US and some other countries. And It is time to set up a task force and to create genuine labels. So this is under consideration, and I welcome individuals and people who would like to help with me to make the police on the web. So this is important, and these are important issues. I'm sure they are here a lot of people, several companies that are working hard to introduce their material and their product made of geopolymer product. They are inventing good names, having innovations, creativities, and you are facing this type of people who are just caught being without providing any credit at all. And I don't like when university people at universities are working for this type of companies and not making themselves their police. So the Catholic University in Washington, I also work there. I don't like this type of behavior, and this could not be, and we have to really look at it very carefully. Geopolymer cement started 27 years ago when I was at North Star Industries in the USA. And it was essentially a material that had a wonderful characteristic, namely early high strength. And this is a small illustration. This is something that I am presenting practically at each conferences. imaging the following. In Los Angeles, a crew begins placing concrete at the airport. In New York, JFK, Boeing is departing. After 1 hour, the cement is strong enough to walk on. After 4 hours, it is strong enough to drive on. And after 6 hours, it is ready for the weight of a commercial jet. This is what has been achieved. And we will have some news 23 years later. What happened? But we have long-term durability with this type of material. I received a letter which reads, my first experience using pyramid was about 23 years ago when we were the first to use it to replace damaged concrete on runways and taxiways at the Atlanta airport. A major aircraft runway intersection at Charleston Air Force Base in South Carolina was replaced with a concrete mix using pyramid cement about 20 years ago. I just learned that they are going to remove and replace one of the runways, but the intersection made out of pyramid is still in such good condition that they are leaving it in place. In 1991, a full runway was replaced at Barksdale Air Force Base in Louisiana using concrete made with pyramid cement. 20 years later, that runway is still being used by US Air Force B-52 bombers. Please use this information as you wish. David L. Barton, Chairman, Primers and Inc., Primers Inc., USA. How the Portland cement industry is reacting to the development of geopolymer cement. Some are reacting in a good way, that they are trying to keep it, to develop it, and some are strongly trying to stop it. And the one company that is strongly trying to stop it is the company, the French company, Lafarge. And this news in French, September 2010, Lafarge élabore un ciment empreinte de CO2 fortement réduit. Lafarge is developing a cement with a very, very low CO2 fingerprint. CO2 emissions strongly reduced. What is the issue? You know, we have Portland cement results from this reaction with the production of CO2. This is chemically based, you cannot change it, which means 1 ton of Portland cement generates 1 ton of CO2. So you turn around, you cannot change the data, or you have to change the chemistry. And this is what they are trying to do. And continue with the news. This is a new product, a new clinker that has 30% less limestone. And this limestone has been replaced by gypsum, clay, and bauxite. And the Lafarge scientists claim that achieved 25% CO2 reduction. And with this 25% CO2 reduction, they lobbied, they filed for a patent that had been issued in 2010, and they are lobbying Brussels, and they got funds for their panel plants. So let us compare what Lafarge is achieving and promoting with the grid noise with what we are achieving. I take one example for rock-based geopolymer cement, which is a good case. And we have two ways. One, we take the waste as it is. That is, we don't care about the CO2 that has been added to during the manufacture. Or we'll do it as if we should have had to manufacture all the ingredients in order to get the exact survey of the CO2 production. This will be discussed tomorrow during the cement session very precisely. And we can compare what we get. Lafarge-Portland cement, best case, is 25% reduction. Of course, afterwards, they may blend the material with other system, like we can also blend them. Rock-based geopolymer cement, the worst case, that is when we are manufacturing everything, 65%, and best case when we are taking all the waste that we can get, 90%. So these are the numbers, and these are the numbers that the farmers are knowing quite well, but they try to deliberate, and we'll discuss it tomorrow. In the meantime, ASTM, the world famous qualification standard, the US one, is organizing in June 2012 in San Diego a symposium on geopolymer binding systems. It says, when performance specifications for hydraulic cement were written, non-Portland binders were uncommon. So we have a problem. Our geopolymer cement does not fit with the common standard. And this is the problem, and the ASTM wants to tackle the issue. And we have to provide to ASTM the good standards. So we have to create our standards. And I would like to have a group of people here or in the next years that will be dedicated to create the geopolymer cement standards that will be presented to ASTM. ASTM are not the experts. They must have experts that provide the information. New binders, such as geopolymers, have been increasingly researched, marketed as specialty products, and explored for use in structural concrete. This symposium is intended to provide an opportunity for ASTM to consider whether the existing cement standards provide, on the one hand, an effective framework for further exploration of geopolymer binders, and on the other hand, reliable protection for users of this material. So we see what happened. In the meantime, we have to use the geopolymer cement for special applications, where the geopolymer cement behaves better than Portland cement. And this is one example. One example from a Japanese team, the head of Kyushi Okada at Tokyo Institute of Technology, and my friend Kenneth McKenzie from New Zealand. Water retention properties of porous geopolymer for use in cooling applications. What is the problem here? I would be surprised. The problem is the following. Rising rising temperatures in big cities are presenting an increasing problem, especially in the summer. This effect arises from the increasing amount of heat generated by human activities and because of the increasing surface areas covered by artificial materials with high solar absorption capacity. For example, the average temperature in Tokyo has increased 3 to 4 degrees C during the last 100 years. Related to this warming, the number of nights in which the temperature in Tokyo does not fall below 25 degrees C, known as tropical nights, has increased from 10 to 15 a decade ago to about 40 at present. This warming phenomenon is called heat island effect. As one possible method for counteracting the heat island effect, we have investigated a passive cooling system using evaporation of water absorbed by porous geopolymers. Passive cooling through porous geopolymer cement. The porosity of geopolymer cement is not a problem. It is an advantage. It provides good properties. Don't destroy it in order to cope with cement codification. This is wrong. Create new ones where the cement, Portland cement, is not capable of achieving it. Another patent on geopolymer cement is this one. This was also filed by the German company. In fact, it is a subsidiary of the BASF, the German company. The title, mixture, in particular construction material mixture containing furnace slag. And in order to show the problem that they think of having solved, I show you a very, very short video of one of our small tutorials.
The Davia tutorial describes the manufacture of a high-strength cement. We show here the easiest method to do it. It is obvious that the use of laboratory equipment makes the operation easier. The lab technician should use overall and gloves and respect the safety and security rules that apply to his laboratory. He may be assisted by a second technician in charge of cleaning the tools immediately in water before the hardening of the binder. Here are the directions for use of a Davia geopolymer cement for simple applications. Prepare 4 parts by weight of powder, 3 parts by weight of hardener, and between 50% and 200% of fillers depending on its granulometry. Here we weight 120 grams of powder. Here comes the hardener, and we weight 90 grams of hardener. Pour the hardener into the powder. Mix the whole with a mixer or by hand until obtaining a fluid resin. Do not add water. Here we use a vibrating machine for a better hand mix. Look how fluid is the resin. we weighed 80 grams of fillers, which is a mixed sand containing quartz, feldspar and other minerals. Pour the fillers into the resin and mix the whole. The use of fillers is mandatory, otherwise the davia binder will crack. Unlike Portland cement, which shrinks when used without fillers, davia cement does not shrink, but cracks. You will observe this characteristic on the top of your samples where some fillers have decanted. We always remove mechanically this fragile layer before carrying out our tests. Cast the mixture in a hermetically closed mold. For Davia 60, the initial set is as short as 60 minutes, starting from the mixing of the binder, followed by a setting time of 25 minutes, thus totalizing 85 minutes from the initial mixing until the complete hardening of the binder at room temperature. The setting time depends on the room temperature. If necessary, to accelerate the setting, let it first set during 2 hours at ambient temperature. This allows the chemical reaction to react completely. Then, place the mold in an oven at 60 degrees C for 2 hours. For this tutorial, we let it harden 24 hours long. You can clean very easily the equipment with water as long as the mixture has not yet hardened. Twenty-four hours later, we demold the sample. Look at the black-green color of the sample during the first day. It is a sign of a good geopolymerization. Once it is set, we place the sample in a plastic bag, hermetically closed, or dip it in water and store it for at least 5 days at room temperature. But for a fully cured material and getting the best results, keep it covered for 28 days. After 5 days, note the condensation of water inside the bag. The polycondensation generates molecular water that is expelled from the network and condenses in form of small drops on the plastic bag. After 28 days, we take out the sample. We still see the black-green color. After 2 or 3 days out, the color has returned to normal.
Okay, so this is the problem. We know it, and we use it because of the slag. A They claim to have solved it by introducing in the mix, so we have several mixes, silica-based, metacarbon-based, and so forth, and they are introducing zinc salt or zinc oxide. And they claim that these colors that are sulfate and sulfate no longer exist from the beginning. We change now from topics, we go to LTGS, to bricks, low-temperature bricks. And there are something interesting news, this time coming from Saudi Arabia. Investigating the possibility of utilizing low-carbonatic clays in production of geopolymer bricks. This is Department of Chemistry, Taif University, and in Egypt, Suez Canal University. So I'm glad that also other labs, universities in the other countries are also tackling the low temperature making of bricks. If we stay with clay and ceramic for high temperature processing, we worked a lot, and there is a chapter on ceramic in geopolymer chemistry and application. And we know that we can really improve the classic cold ceramic manufacture by reducing the energy that is consumed in making these ceramics. So there have been big trials that have been done in a very renowned clay brick manufactured facility, but the problem with this industry, the clay brick industry, they don't want to go public. They don't want to have the result published at all. So I'm just telling what has been done. They run a pilot plant of 90 tons of material, and they reduce the production times of regular range from 35 hours to 16 hours. But this system is also used to make regular high-tech ceramic. The title is geopolymer composite, but this is geopolymer ceramic. It's not geopolymer fiber composite, by Corning in the US. And what we read is the geopolymer ceramic may be extruded to form structures such as honeycomb monoliths, and we fired at temperatures of below 1100 degrees C. The cost of manufacturing objects using the material of the invention is substantially reduced in comparison with typical production of conjugate-based bodies due to the substantially shortened firing time. So it's not only bricks, but only variable technical ceramics that can be reduced because of the geopolymer precursor system. Let us continue now with another issue related to clay and in general. This is a publication from Rigas Technica Universitate, this is in Latvia, comparative study of elite clay and elite based geopolymer products. And they write in their abstract, quaternary clay deposits are one of the dominating parts of mineral raw materials of the sedimentary cover at present area of Latvia. Their clays can be characterized by elite content up to 70 to 80%. This is a problem. I usually say, don't touch this type of clay, it doesn't work. But they are working on it because they must do it, and they are solutions. Two ways for use of elite clays were studied: conventional and geopolymer method. So they are systems. And at the same time, I got another information from Germany. bringt an der Blauton auf den Sprung zum Geopolymer. Blue clay bringt an der Involvement with Geopolymer. We are also dealing with this type of clay, and there is a strong delegation of Greifswald University here for the same objective. In fact, if we look at the Baltic Sea or North Sea environment, so we find Riga, Latvia, working on the topic. We find the Greifswald University, but we have another guy that we know. He is his third time here at the Geopolymer Camp, Jaron Wood, and he will present his result. I wrote him, it will not work. And now maybe he's coming with something. We'll see.
Challenge.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm
presenting tomorrow.
Clays. I've been working with some Calamithic Portuguese clays.
So okay, we'll present tomorrow. So this is the situation. You see, with courage and perseverance, you achieve something. So let us finish with the Geopolymer and archaeology. We wrote a new book on the pyramids, the way things were done, and the title of the book is Why the Pharaohs Built the Pyramid with Fake Stones. And this is a non-exhaustive list of scientists, of colleagues that are endorsing this theory. You find prestigious universities, starting from MIT and so forth, but it's not finished. And I have to add to this list Japanese one, Professor Ikeda from Yamaguchi University, because he was part of a famous Japanese TV show where they replicated the system once. So, I have a question. So, you know, how many of you have watched our small video on the making of the 15 tons of Geopolymer Camp stone cement that we made in 2002? Please raise the hand. So the majority don't have it, so we'll run it. So, the story continues. This year, we had from New Scientist a report on first images from Great Pyramid's Chamber of Secrets. What do we have here? We have just a visual cross section of the Pyramid of Cheops, and there are two nodes, two shafts, 20 centimeters by 20 centimeters that extend from the north and south walls of the Queen Chamber. The function of these tunnels and doors is unknown. It's not the function that I'm interested in, it is their shape. And we have here a beautiful sketch which shows the fact that these tunnels, here the rubber that was inside, are inverted U blocks, at least 10 meters long, without any joints. One piece, and for us, it is obvious that this is a precast Geopolymer limestone concrete. Otherwise, it is impossible to make it out of carved limestone block. So we have here a genuine example of precasting Geopolymer limestone concrete according to our method. This is the end of my state of Geopolymer research and development, and you are welcome to our coffee break.